Thank you all for coming tonight. It's a beautiful night out, so it's quite nice that everybody showed up. Everybody's about a gardening and stuff too, but I think this is an important project for the town. I've been here 8 months, and this is by far the project that I've had the most discussion with folks on. And I know a lot of work has been put into this project. So I'll step out of the way and let those who have been at the forefront of this project speak. And we'll start with Select Board Member Fred Orlowski. He'll talk about the work of the Municipal Building Committee.
Thank you, Brian. I've got a short presentation here about kind of an overview, history, and how we got where we're at and what's our next steps. I'm not the only presenter. As you picked up the agenda, you see we've had quite a few other people on here to vary the presentation and the speakers. First off, I say a good evening for everybody showing up. Thank you for attending, and especially thank you presenters that agreed to make a presentation. They're part of the program that directly affects the town hall project. We did other things that they're involved in, but that's not our focus here today. Before we get started, I'd like to recognize some of the people on these committees that have been working since last fall. We've been meeting probably every 2 or 3 weeks with the architect, should say, to come to this point in the project to finalize what we all think is the best project for the town hall. Okay. Hope I don't forget anybody. Okay. On the building committee, we've had 8 people primarily involved in the project most recently. And I'd like to personally recognize all of these people. Would you please stand up? Odelia Bardwell. Virginia Alice. Okay. Anita Husted. And Ed Swapovitz. Is Ed? Okay, sitting there. Okay, Dan Kennedy, is he? I don't see him here. John Robleski and Judy Marklin is the other one from the building committee. And the historic commission has also been greatly involved, I would say, in the last year and a half, maybe 2 years, and did a major effort in applying for the grants that we're hoping will come through for this project. They'll talk about that a little later on. On the Historic Commission, Alan McArthur is the chair. He's not here. Judy Marklin is a member of the Historic Commission. Donna Wiley, also a member. And Susan Barron is the other member that's been involved. So. And Darcy. Tony is a member. So I guess I'd like to personally thank them for all the time and effort, especially for the last year since we've been working with the architect. And the architect is here with us today, George Dole from Jones Woodset Architects is here. He's been our contact with the architect on this project. Okay. We have about an hour of presentations here. We follow the agenda. I've asked everybody to be timely, given time slots out for each one, so we're not spending a half hour on each presentation. If you feel that if you have questions, please wait till the end if possible. If not, I guess you can write them on the back of the agenda card if you want and leave them with somebody. Last time we met, we had a few comments that way that were very important, so please express your comments, concerns, one way or another. The plans and specifications are on the table here if anybody wants to look after the meeting in more detail or certain aspects of the project. There's also going to be 2 meetings coming up, open public meetings, if anybody wants to come and talk to the committee or look at the plans. We've got one tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock, and there's another one scheduled for May 1st. So, The Municipal Building Committee started this project in January of 2011. Some of you have been involved in attending meetings since then, and others, this is fairly new. So we've gone through 6 years of planning for this project. We're still not done. We're in final stages that we hope to be done in the next several months. And we hope this is a reasonable project that is sorely needed, and it's something that is realistic to scale for what the town needs for a town hall. And we're here today, the Building Committee, Historic Commission, Community Preservation Committee, and Finance Committee, to provide information for your support here and at the annual town meeting. As there will be vote on funding for this coming up at the annual town meeting, and you'll see that later on in the agenda. We feel that we've developed a reasonable project that has been done by various town committees. And I'll show you there has been quite a bit of town interest, other committees and boards in this project. And the final outcome, and you'll see in the funding, is there is no additional cost to taxpayers. We're going to implement this project. That's our emphasis, our goal here, is to convince and show people with facts, with evidence, with copies of plans, what we're doing, that there's no increase in cost to the taxpayers, no additional cost to taxpayers. So, okay, let me proceed now with what I prepared for a presentation on how the latest version of this project was developed. Okay, what I'm going to talk about here is it's kind of an overview slide. Why are we going to renovate? Why we need to do something? What major projects have been happening associated with the town hall? There has been projects that have nothing significant. Well, there is at various time periods, but nothing recently. What are the positive features of the building? Why do we need to preserve and renovate? You've heard plenty of times before that all the negative things about the building, and we're not here to talk about the negative, really, about what's good, what's positive in the building. Why keep it? Why preserve it? Project development, what's happening, who's involved, and how we got to this stage. Financial support, you'll hear some more about that. Cost estimate, what's included in the cost estimate? I'll get into some basic facts on that. Our schedule. Where do we go from here? We'll talk about that briefly. And adversity is really some comments that we've been hearing from the public on the project. We'll address some of them. I will talk about one specifically, and the rest will be during the presentations. Okay, why renovate? First off, Historic Society needs a home. They're currently in the center school. So we have the center school building and the town hall that aren't really used for very much today. And our plan is to move the Historic Society into the town hall. There's more room, they need additional space, something that's more secure, environmentally controlled. They need that, and the best option to do that is in the town hall. We need to start preserving our historic buildings. How many historic buildings do we have today? Other than the town hall, the library, I guess you could consider the church. We have center school for now. We don't know what's going to happen with it, so we keep losing buildings. Coming up in 4 years, we're going to have, hopefully, a celebration, 250th celebration. We need a place to hold this rather than have it on a ball field under a tent. And I think the Historic Society and others discussing plans of how we can make this a grand celebration like we did 50 years ago. They need a place to do that. Access and use of the second floor. The building is used today somewhat by some town offices and some private organizations on the first floor. But the second floor is a big open hall that is not used at all. Part of the reason is for access. In wintertime, there's no heat. That's basically all we need to do for the second floor, to make it usable. And of course, we're in the final stages of completing planning and design. We can't study it any further. This is about the end of the process for design. Okay, major town hall projects. The building was built, constructed in 1844. It was raised up, the second floor added in 1871. In 1949, a concrete foundation was added. And in 1967 to 1971, the building was modernized. That's what it was called when the committee got together to do that for the bicentennial celebration. It was over a four-year period where plumbing was added to the building, added insulation and other things to modernize the building. And we're hoping in 2017 and into 18 that renovations of this building will occur. Okay. Some positive features. Location. What better location to have a town hall than the center of the town? Here's a picture looking out the back, the view from the back of the town hall. It's a good location for town activities, for functions, for community use. It's a sound structure. The building is built well. It's got a lot of framing for the walls and the roof that we're maintaining. We don't need to replace all that. There's minor stuff will be replaced, but majority of it, it's a sound building, sound foundation. John will talk a little about how we're going to maintain and improve the foundation. It's got a slate roof that's been on here for 150 years. We're going to keep that. We're not going to remove that. There's some minor repairs that will be done. The windows, they're original, and we're going to try to maintain them. John will get into again how we're going to do that, and it's been proven that we've looked at replacing them with new windows. It's not any more cost effective to do that than trying to preserve what we have. And the plaster drywall, that was done in 1970 for the bicentennial. We're not touching that. That's a positive attribute of the building, especially the second floor. We're not gonna remove all that to the bare studs. Okay, other features. Insulation, the building was insulated. Upstairs is all insulated, and majority of the first floor, except the entryways in the front, first floor and second floor. We're gonna add insulation there and also in the ceiling. Septic system, it just passed Title V inspection. There's nothing wrong with the septic system for that building. We've had it pumped and had it inspected, and that's the result. Hardwood floors, second floor, to be maintained, refinished. Wainscoting, you see in the entryway, and on the second floor, it's going to be maintained, and what is, or will be replaced, to all look the same. Lighting, you can see two pictures I found here of school lighting here. And also a chandelier here. They're on the second floor. These are on the first floor. These will be maintained. We're going to rewire, put LED lighting in. That's just as efficient, cost effective as buying new lighting. So, okay, exposed beams. When you first walk into the building, you see the exposed beams on the ceiling. They're all going to be maintained in their front hallway. Then what's there now will be maintained, and maybe new ones added on more towards the back. Okay. How have we developed this project? We've got several players involved. I'm trying to focus on the orange ones are the primary players that have been involved for the past 6 or 9 months. The building committee involved the historic commission, Jones Whitsett Architects, and town administration been involved in the funding and monitoring the progress of it. We've been meeting, like I said, every 2 or 3 weeks, finalize plans. We've also got input from all these departments in town and the building inspector. He's been on once or twice to look at what needs to be done, what meets code, what doesn't, what we have to do on the building. Highway Department has been involved in the septic, some of the parking lot, Fire Department on providing fire protection. We're not sure exactly how we're going to do that, but it's being discussed. In the Water Department, we're going to hook up new water service to the building, whether it's from the Water District or combined Water District departments. So we'll have new water service, so. Using other project information, we looked at all these reports that were done before, several years ago, to see what was done to the building. And mentioned 68 to 71, in the town reports, you can see a report of Town Hall Renovation Committee. That's where we realized the building was insulated, there was new drywall put in on all the walls, a tin ceiling on a second floor was removed, all the drywall. We're not touching that, we're going to maintain that. That's going to stay the way it is, it's acceptable. The building inspector said that is adequate. In 2002, there was a Greenberg Associates study on Town Hall Buildings and Site Evaluation Report. It looked at combining buildings, the Town Hall, Fire Station, Police Station, and what we got out of that was the parking lot design that we're trying to talk to. We'll be talking to an architect with. It does make some sense to continue, so we got that from that study. The Conway School of Design has done a master plan for Whately Center Historic District. And there they are recommending changes on the drainage on the parking lot. We're considering some of that information as well. Okay. So I mentioned this has been going on most recently for 6 years. We started in 2011 with a feasibility study that was looked at the town hall, the center school, and what was the best use of the buildings. That resulted in 2014, town hall, a study on using the town hall as an office building. Excavating the basement, having a full basement, put all town offices in there. That was before we bought the Wormles building, library building. We're looking at putting all town offices in that one building, in the town hall, for $3.9 million. Taxpayers didn't want to spend that much money to do that. So the next result was looking at just the town hall as a community center. That's what our focus has been lately, to reduce this cost from 3.9 down to something that's reasonable, and how to fund it at that cost. And that's what we've come up with, is the $1.3 million right now. And I'll show you what that represents in a minute, but when we just started the study here on the town hall, we were up to $1.7 million as a project, and we worked with the architect, the committee worked with the architect to reduce that cost, and we're comfortable with the $1.3 million. What we spent so far, I looked at all I could find, the records, what we spent, town meetings, what money was obligated, what we spent. We spent $320,000 to study this building. And it's time that we do something with that money. The committee is feeling that we don't need to spend any more money on the design of the building. We're there. We reached the final design. We don't need to spend more than the $320,000 we've already spent. Okay. Where is the support for this coming from? They got the $1.3 million is what we're shooting for. Our target for this is what we're hoping the project will cost when we go out to bids. You can see here we're looking for state grants. We've got four grants here we're applying for funding for. We've already applied for all of these. These are the dollar amounts. And we'll see a presentation on what these represent and what the match is for each of these later on. Town funds over here, there's two categories. The town is looking at supporting this project through these two categories of funds. You'll hear more from that from the CPA committee and also from our finance committee. We also have fundraising here It's also undergoing, some has been done already, and they're expecting more to occur here. And that's their contribution, their goal. If you add up all these categories of funds, we come to slightly over the $1.3 million. So we feel comfortable that, you know, it's assuming we get 100% of the grant applications, that we can come up with enough funds to fund a $1.3 million project. What does the $1.3 million include? It includes all the construction, labor, and materials for the building. That was roughly $1 million. That's what that amount came to. We had some contract additives for some contingencies, some overhead, some profit in there. And also, the next step would be construction contract administration. We have a contractor working there. We need somebody to oversee what he's doing, making sure he follows plans and specifications and building code requirements. We're also including an add alternative for cost of the front parking lot improvements. We're proposing the project be bid as the building itself with improvements to parking on the side and minimal in the front. And there's also an option we're looking at is for constructing the front parking lot completely. So it will be bid as two items. I guess that gives us some leeway if the bids come over the 1.3, we can exclude this for the time being and do it at a later time. Okay, and we also got some final bid changes here before we go to advertising that will be included in that price. Okay, what's our schedule look like here? Say we've got a meeting coming up tomorrow. We're having joint meetings with Building Committee and Historic Commission at 6 o'clock to talk about other items related to the project. April 25th is annual town meeting. We're asking you to support for the project to fund what we're proposing. We're also another building committee meeting on May 1st. It's open to the public. Anybody has comments, wants to see what's going on in more detail, ask questions, please come. May and June, we're hoping to finalize design plans and specifications. And July will be grant notifications of the three grants we applied for, how much, if any, we're getting of the three. August, we plan on advertising for construction bids. October is the renovation starting and completed sometime in May 2018. Okay. Two more slides here. Addressing comments. We're going to cover most of these in the following speakers. Community use, we've got a presentation on how much use there's going to be for the building today and in the future. Fire protection, talk about that. Tax implications from financing. The one big thing is parking. We've heard several people comment that why renovate when you don't have room to park? Well, we all know the location of the building. What can you do to improve parking? You're kind of restricted by what's there. We're increasing, my count is existing parking is like 10 spaces. We're going to increase that to about 26 in the front and on the side of the building. We're going to increase to that much. We have the potential to do that. The other things, you know, the Conway School of Design suggested we move the War Memorial and demolish Smike's house for parking. Well, nobody thought that was a practical solution. The other option is along Chestnut Plain Road, along the street, or on library property, or the center school property. That's still an option for increasing parking. But without major changes, you know, we're limited to the site itself, and we feel we can get 26 parking spaces there, which is a lot more than we have today. Okay, and finally, it's our town hall. Let's take pride in it and show the community that we have a viable building that can be used for community use. This is what it looks like several years ago. Memorial Day celebration. Let's continue to make it our town hall that we can preserve for another 50 years, to have a celebration in 2021 that will last, and the building will last for another 50 years. Okay? That's all I have. I would turn it over now to John Robleski. He's going to talk about some of the final plans and features.
Beginning, this Fred alluded to a couple of times, we've, as committees, have worked pretty hard on this the last, you know, over a year. We've taken time to meet with not only the architects, but we've gone on field trips. People have gone to other cities and towns that have done similar projects. We've gone, like, on little trips to Amherst College to look at the window issue and how they dealt with the similar situation. It really came out well. So we put a lot of time into this and thought, and we've met with the cost estimators face-to-face, because they tend to look at like kind of a blue book type thing, and here's your estimate, and we kind of corrected them on several issues there to get this down to a reasonable factual number. As far as the layout, this is the old building, the way it sits now, the front door is out here. So the only demolition part would be the bathroom area here and the wall between what's currently, or was, the town collector's office and the bathroom. The back part of this floor, typically where we used to vote, you can feel it sagging there when you walk over it. Well, that's going to be taken up and all the reinforcing done underneath there. The new layout, we put the Historical Society Museum on the north side of the building there. It gives them a lot of space there, plus two closets, one in the front that's currently there underneath the stairway. We're just moving the door from there over to there. And adding another closet up here that will also have a hatchway to get to the crawl space underneath there. That's where all the plumbing and wiring is going to be for most of the first floor. This will be the meeting room, like snowmobile club, the Grange, any other, you know, small groups I want to use that. The vault there, and I'll get into it a little bit later, but the vault, instead of tearing that out, which would be quite of an expense because it's 12-inch thick concrete or steel reinforcing in there, we decided just to open up the other side and cut a door in there. We got an estimate of $3,800 to do that. That way we use the vault as dry storage area off of that room there. Then the two bathrooms would be added where the current assessor's office was. Fred said the layout. All right, so the only thing that we're doing on the second floor is this part of the stage here will be cut out because the stairway that would be added in the back there, this is the current plan. Now, the stairway that's added there is at the same level there as it is in the main auditorium. So this needs to be a wheelchair accessible lane right there. Then we're also adding a storage closet there. Everything else upstairs, as Fred said, is basically in fine shape. There's no cracks in the ceilings or the walls and so forth. So basically it's going to be painted. Then the addition on the back is basically a stairway and a lift instead of an elevator. And it's a three-stop lift. stops at the first floor, the main second floor here, and then the stage level, which is mandated by ADA. So the cost difference there from that 3.9 to this, 3.9, the elevator was 131,000. This is 31,000. That does the same job. Where's the... I don't do PowerPoint. Yeah, I already went over this here. The foundation, as Fred said, they looked at that early on in this investigation. They dug right along the edge of the foundation, and there's three courses of cement block on top of a 21-inch thick by 12-inch wide footing of solid concrete. And that's pretty much on solid gravel base. So it hasn't moved since 1949 when it was done. And we're going to take the insulation out of the crawl space that's there now. It's basically fallen down onto the ground, coming up between the floor joists. And they don't recommend insulating inside the crawl spaces anymore, so it's going to be ventilated in there. But we're going to add insulation to the exterior of the block vertically, and then out about 3 feet, I believe, George, 2.5, 3 feet, horizontally, so that protects from any frost attempting to get in here. But again, it hasn't moved since 49. Septic system, there's really no change in use to the building according to the health code. So we were able to get the Title V inspection done on that, made sure all the pipes were in good shape and everything was flowing and it passed Title V with no problem. So that saves us $170,000 versus doing a new septic system, which ended up being done behind the town hall, if you remember from the original plan. But we also have the easement there, so in the event that the current system fails in the future, we have the easement, which already has pipes in it, to get down to that area behind the library. And what we're gonna do is run a pipe from that, one of those three pipes that are in the ground there, over to about where the existing tank is. So the parking area that we're going to be doing here won't be dug up again in a number of years if that comes to be. The heating and air conditioning, it's all going to be what they call a mini split. The VRV means variable refrigerant flow. So basically that means that if room A over here is too cold, they can put the heat on, and the room next to it is too warm, they can put the air conditioning on from the same system. So it's a very high-tech thing and very economical to run. So the entire building will be heated and air conditioning, and the propane that's in there now will be taken out. There's only a couple of, you know, space heaters basically that are in there now, so all that will be gone. The roofing, the existing slate, already had some repairs to it. Last year, the ridge cap was kind of blowing off, so we had a roofer come in, do some patching of the slate, and also put a copper ridge cap right on top of the whole building. That's already been done. And the barn that's there, of course, is in very disrepair, so that's gonna come down, but we're gonna take the slate off of that individually and be able to use that because it matches what's on the current building and do the patchwork with that slate. The chimneys, you find out that according to the historical guidelines, those chimneys are part of the building design from that era. So we're gonna maintain the exterior chimneys, rebuild them, repoint whatever they need, and redo the slate and the flashing around the bottom. This is what I mentioned about the elevator versus the lift. Fire safety, the whole issue of sprinklers has been tossed around. The fire chief would prefer sprinklers, but we don't have the capacity from the town district system to supply the pressure or the quantity of water needed to sustain a sprinkler system. And if you think back when that nightclub in Rhode Island burned and 100 people perished, the laws changed after that, so any bar, restaurant, that type of thing had to jury rig or retrofit and put in sprinklers. And the way the building is set up, it it's going to be, there's no difference in cost whether we do it now or at some point later when the water's available. So that can be easily done later on. The alarm and detectors that will be hardwired there will go directly to the dispatch in Shelburne Falls and probably eventually to the fire department right here too. So it's a very well-designed and high-tech system there with alarms and CO detectors, heat sensors, all that. Vault area, I already told you about that. It made no sense to try to take that out. It would have been quite a project to jackhammer it apart piece by piece and get it out. And cutting the new door in there makes perfect sense. And we're actually leaving the vault door that's there. It'll be exposed in the ladies' room as a conversation piece. So you don't hope nobody has a combination, right? The electrical, basically the building's going to be all electric, so we're going to need a 400 amp service versus a 200 amp service that's currently in the building. The telephone pole in the center of the parking lot, between the edge of the parking lot and Chestnut Plain Road, has a 3-inch conduit where they can pull a new 400 amp service right through there, right to where it's got to go. The historical lighting, Fred mentioned that. And instead of having a water heater like in the bathrooms and down near the kitchen area, I didn't point that out before, but there is a little kitchenette area that's on the backside of the Historical Society Museum that enters into the hallway that the meeting room can use or anybody upstairs come down the back stairs. Pretty basic, you know, kitchen range with a vent hood, microwave and refrigerator and sink. But using point-of-use water heaters, we thought made pretty good sense because you're not keeping 80 gallons or 40 gallons of water hot all the time. So when you turn on a faucet, it heats what you need and that's it. Fred mentioned that drywall was done in 1970 upstairs. You know, I sat there and looked at it and I said, well, what's wrong with it? You know, if it's not broke, we're not going to fix it. So it's not broke, we're not fixing it. We're going to paint it. The first floor, some of the office areas have like the old old wallpaper on there. And that's the easiest way to deal with that is we're putting 1/4-inch drywall over those areas. So it's basically going to be new drywall there, but we're not tearing it out. And most of the exterior walls have the insulation that's been verified. And with the way those windows are going to be done, we went over to Amherst College, and there's a company in New Hampshire, Window Masters, and they actually take those sashes out, and the mullions that are in between there, the bars, they give it the design, they shim or trim like whatever they need off of one side or the other of that, and then they put in insulated low-E glass with argon in there, very energy efficient, meets the stretch of it. And the way they did it at Amherst College, I was quite impressed with the seals along the side for the sash met. It's really like a brand new window, and they're going to look exactly the way they do now in the building. It was a very cost-effective way of doing it. The site work, Fred mentioned about 20 spaces in the front. We went out there and measured the existing parking area, and it's really not going to change a lot from what's there now. If we had lines on that parking lot, I think it would be a lot clearer as to how to pull in and park. Because there's no lines here, people kind of park, you know, parallel this way and pull in the other way. So, but I think just having that, and it's not going to take up a heck of a lot more area than the blacktop that's already there. And that's with keeping the memorial where it is and staying away from it, no problem. And we would look at doing some site work as far as dealing with the drainage, you know, from that whole area that basically kind of runs down Chestnut Plain Road. That's part of the Conway School of Design thing, and maybe the new or green streets. What do they call that, Judy? Complete streets? Yeah. And that's the pipe I mentioned about, you know, adding it from the easement over to the current thing. And we're planning ahead for underground work. We'd be putting in, well, we got a trench open on the south side of the parking lot for a new water service. We're also going to tap into the 8-inch main there with a 6-inch main that comes to the building. It'll be capped off for now, but instead of digging it up again later, like with the sewer, it's there, so in the event that two water systems get merged and there's plenty of supply and pressure, it's already there, so we're not doing it twice. So it's kind of a realistic project at this point. All that funding comes through, it'll be a home run, and I think it's long overdue, and like they say, if you build it, they will come. I think it will be used, so we look for your support.
Yes.
John said, if we build it, they will come. Well, that was part of the process here, was to make sure if we build it, they will come. Obviously, this is an important town asset that we want to preserve and make nice, but we also want to make sure that all of the work that we are doing in this building is something that will serve the needs of the community. So, to that end, we conducted two different surveys, one relatively early on in this generation of the project, and one more recently, among local organizations and individuals who use space to find out if they would be interested in using this space and understand what their specific needs were for space. And we got an amazing number of responses to this survey, given we're talking about a relatively small community with a limited number of organizations. And these are just what I'm going to call the community-based organizations. And they range from, we knew the Historical Society was interested, they've been part of the planning process, but we've got things like the Snowmobile Club, as we talked about, in the Grange, but we also have a number of entertainment organizations, if you want to call them that, Watermelon Wednesdays, Milk Bottle, Green River Tap and Die, a number of organizations were excited to have local space where they could rehearse and perform. We also had interest from what I'm going to call municipal organizations. Things like, well, let me start with the library. Originally, the library wasn't that excited because they have the library space. Well, the new librarian just recently realized she can't hold library functions at the library. The library's book group, for example, this month is being moved to the church because the library isn't handicap accessible. That is a barrier. So we've got the Agricultural Commission and CESA who are excited to use the space for informational events and public events for the agricultural community. Just a wide variety of organizations interested in using this. So because we did two surveys, part of the responses were input that helped us design what that space should be. And part of the responses were after the fact when we, to some other organizations, you have to understand different organizations responded to the two surveys. The second survey was, if we have this space, would you be interested? So based on what we got from the organizations that are interested in using the space, the committee has designed the building to have the large meeting room downstairs that John was talking about that will accommodate up to 30 people for a good size meeting, but not the kind of meeting where there's so many people that you need row seating like this. For that, we've got the auditorium, which will be made accessible and can accommodate roughly 150 or more people. There will be a fully outfitted kitchen, and every space in the building will be handicap accessible, which in today's world is an absolute necessity and something we need to do for our community anyway. How would they use this space? A wide variety of uses were suggested. They would have the same organizations in the survey were telling us they would have meetings, they would have lectures, workshops and classes. CESA was excited to be able to do workshops there. Performances, rehearsals, because there are a number of both music and dance organizations based out of our town. benefits, fundraisers, things like, you know, the crafts fair that the library does, which can't be at the library anymore because it's not handicap accessible. There will be exhibit space within the Historical Society area, but then there will also be other areas of the building where other organizations can have a photography exhibit or an art exhibit or something like that. And then specific to the agricultural community, there was interest in informational sessions, not just for people within Whately, but they look for centrally located facilities that allow them to bring people from the surrounding towns together. They also run producer-buyer meet and greets, as they call them, which is really fostering the agricultural business within town. So these are the kinds of things that came up in our survey. Well, the last survey was done just about a year ago, maybe 9 months ago. And since then, the world has changed a lot. Just people have had more ideas and different things have come up. So these are things that were not in the survey, but that we've been approached about afterwards that people would like to do. Some of these have been mentioned already, but we need a venue for the 250th anniversary. A friend was talking about that before. That's going to be a big event, and this would be the perfect place to be sort of the center of all of that. But we can also have ongoing events or periodic events. Apparently, long before I lived here, there was a community-wide Halloween party. Things like that can be reinstated. Community-wide tag sales. And then there's also been interest expressed from private organizations, private organizations and private individuals, to use it as a venue for whether it's a wedding or a banquet. One organization asked if we did this, I was talking to the person, they wanted to know, could they run a blood drive there? I said, yes, that would be great. And the last thing that I want to say is those organizations that are not what I'm going to call municipal organizations, meaning the library, the Ag Commission, things like that, we asked them, would they be willing to pay a fee to use the space? And virtually to a one, they said yes. Now, we have not gotten far enough in the process to have worked out what that fee schedule is, so I can't answer questions on that today. But we know that they're not expecting to just be handed the keys for free. They're willing to contribute to use this space. So with all of these types of uses, we feel that this is a good investment in the community because it serves a lot of needs and provides a lot of opportunities for good community activities. I now turn it over to Donna, who is going to talk about the grant fund. Oh, you don't want to? That I don't know how to do.
Okay. Hi, I'm going to give you a break from the PowerPoint. You should each have picked up a sheet. It's printed on two sides about the grant proposals that we've submitted. And I just, before I start talking about them, I want to say, I think Fred and John talked about the fact that the Planning Committee and the Historical Commission have been meeting together for 6 to 12 months. We've actually been meeting since November of 2015, about every 2 weeks. It's been a terrific process, but I don't really want to think about how many hours we've spent on meeting together. Early on in the process of working together, those of us who are on the Historical Commission met separately and said, we're going to try to find some money for the project. We had gone through pretty quickly and gotten agreement on the most important historical components of the building, and we had preserved all of those in the design. But we knew that we wanted to be able to get as much outside money as we could. So between and all of us, every one of us on the Historical Commission has been part of this with our honorary member, Brian Gauna, who has worked very, very closely with us and very hard to get these proposals in. We submitted three proposals probably worked on them starting in October until 10 days ago when the third one went in. And what was really interesting about the process, I mean, I'd be happy to answer anything that's on the piece of paper, but I don't need to read it to you. The way this project has come together, it allowed us to approach the state through three different grant programs that are for three different purposes. And we actually asked in the beginning, the grant officers, is it okay if we're applying for state funds for overlapping purposes? And they all said, that's great, you know, do as long as you're not applying for more than the total project, that's completely fine. So the first was the Mass Cultural Facilities Fund, which was interesting to us because given that the Historical Society Museum is now moving into the building and the auditorium can be called entirely cultural, we could say honestly that 80% of the building will be for cultural purposes. This program has a lot of interest in encouraging tourism. And one of the things that we did, Adelia Bargwalt had made most of these calls, I mean just a couple of them, was this was actually sort of fun. We called a lot of local organizations like Asami and Quan Quan and Bay State Perennials, and Adelia, you talked to all three of the bed and breakfasts, Watermelon Wednesday, just so that we could tell, we could document how many visitors from outside the town and the county, which is they're interested in appealing to visitors for more than 50 miles. And we were able to make a pretty good detailed case for how many people are already coming into Whately. We talked about this project as being sort of a centerpiece for that kind of activity. You'll see that I've listed all the organizations that gave us supporting letters. I want to say specifically that in town, Lisa and Chip Clock were terrifically helpful. Larry Kuttner, who wrote letters for the Cultural Council, Paul Newland, who put on his Watermelon Wednesday hat, and all the chairs of all the other committees that that we've noted. Stephen Kulik and his staff member came and spent 90 minutes with us. I was amazed that he stayed for so long talking with us about the town hall project. I think they're going to be pretty as helpful as they can. And we had a really nice letter from the chief curator of Historic Deerfield about how important the collection of the Historical Society is. And I think, given that this is a cultural program, that will be helpful. The second proposal was of a totally different nature, to the Green Communities Fund. And we, for that, had to put together, and this was really Judy and Brian who did this work, with some good help from the program officer, some very detailed work about the utilities use and energy use in the building now and the improvements we are proposing and what difference it would make for the cost. And we've demonstrated very nicely that even though the building will be used more than it has been, it will cost us less to run it because of all the things that John Robleski just told you about that we're doing. And then finally, the smallest proposal, but I think the Massachusetts Preservation Projects Fund, obviously their purpose is to preserve historic buildings, and we put in a proposal that is primarily about the windows, the chimneys, the wooden roof, wooden floor and wainscoting, all of that, and again had some good supporting letters. So we'll see. We will hear from all three of them in June and July, and they're all competitive. So we think we put good proposals in. Only the Green Communities Fund, I think, may give us a little bit of a hint about how we're doing. The others are closed review processes. So I just want to mention there is, not for the building, but another possibility, the Complete Streets Program, which is a relatively new program in Massachusetts. Whately is in the queue for support. That is especially for improving access for pedestrians, cyclists, public transportation, kind of to encourage something other than automobiles. And if that program continues, we think there's a good chance that we may be able to get some money to improve the sidewalks and the lighting in the center of town, which would obviously help. So that is all that I have to say.
Thank you. Hey, everybody, I'm Al Sanderson, I'm chairman of the Whately Community Preservation Committee. There's two handouts I'm going to be referring to. One is the CPA overview, which, just for your own information, refreshes your memory on what the CPA is, what the CPC does, the committee themselves. And the second one is the project that the CPA or CPC has voted on for this coming year. The CPC is comprised of 7 members, 1 at large, and 6 others from various committees in town. We have been involved in the town hall project since we talked about having it for offices. I think we came up with, we recommended $80,000 for the study and design back then. That didn't pass. We have our offices here along Plain Road. Now we've been approached by both the Historic Commission and the Municipal Building Committee to help fund this new project. We have voted a couple of meetings ago to come up with, onto this, the back of this page, the project recommendations. $340,000 out of our cash reserves, which is the unallocated cash reserves. We also voted, just in case all these grants do not come at total what we asked for, to borrow up to $400,000 as a backstop in case, again, some of these grants don't come through or the total amount doesn't come through. If we do borrow with using CPA money, we can only borrow based on what the local levy is, not on what the state may match us. The state may stop matching. But we still have to have CPA. We cannot opt out of CPA while there is borrowing being done. We can reduce the amount from 3% to 2% if that covers the cost of the debt, but we can't opt out completely. So if you're thinking, well, what if we borrow and then we want to get out of CPA? Well, you can't. We have to stay in the CPA until the debt is paid off. So I just want to let you know that the CPA really thinks this is a very good project. It benefits one of our plan, our master plan for CPC. One of our priorities is projects that benefit the majority of the people in town. And this, we believe, does benefit the majority of the people in town. Thanks.
While we're waiting for this to boot up, my name is Paul Lantay. I'm with the Finance Committee, and this is Fred Barron.
Also
with the Finance Committee. And he is the PowerPoint expert on the Finance Committee, so we're very happy to have Fred here.
On the Finance
Fred and I are going to tag team on this, and as you can see by the handout, and as you can see by the screen in a moment, let me say that the Finance Committee is completely in back of this project. We recommend it fully. We've heard from every possible committee in town that's been associated with the project. And the way we see it right now, there will never, ever be another time like this. Given the funding, given the monies that are available, given the amount of time that people in town have put into the project, this is not going to happen again. So the time is now.
Can we do a slide? Put it on a full slide.
At five, one looks like a podium, that one.
Here we go. Okay. Okay, great. Well, Fred obviously started with this slide earlier in the presentation. And when I say that we are, I guess for lack of a better term, at a confluence of a number of elements which make this a superb time. Not only do we have hopes, great hopes on these grants, but we also have CPA monies that are there and available for us. The town itself has $315,000 that we want to put towards the plan, which we'll speak to at a few slides downstream. And we have the option of CPA borrowing, which again is not going to impact tax rate. And last but not least, a significant effort on the part of trying to get fundraising within the town.
Okay, as Paul said, right now the town is in a very good position to undertake this project. We've got town reserves, which after this project is accounted for, still account for over $400,000, which is roughly 10% of the annual budget of the town, which is a healthy number. That does not include free cash, which is essentially the short-term, it fluctuates and used for short-term spending. That's not even included in this. These are just capital funds that we have. After this, there will be, in the cell tower proceeds fund, which Paul will talk about in the next slide, there will still be $16,000 left. That's from sale of cell tower and can be used for a couple other projects. But that will be enough to fund one more good, solid capital project that is needed, not of this size, but a, you know, probably in some building or some equipment that we need that we wouldn't be able to do without tax increases otherwise. So, Paul, go for the cell tower.
Okay, regarding, obviously this was a huge windfall for us. You can see the sale of $1.2 million. And when we looked at these monies, both the select board as well as the finance committee, you know, you have the option. This is like hitting the lottery. You can nickel and dime it all year long, or you can invest it in your own backyard so that you see the results of these monies year in and year out. And that's what we felt was the best thing to do. So right off the bat, we paid off the town office, which left us with these monies here. And we felt that the next best place to put our money was in this town hall. Because these monies did not come from taxation. They didn't come from my pocketbook or anyone else in this room. It was a windfall. We got lucky. We sold a piece of land that went for a good buck. And I think we should try to take advantage of that. And obviously we also put money into the town, the new town hall, for the vault, and we have some remaining funds. But if you look at it, we took that $1.2 million and we've, up to this point, we've reinvested nearly 70% of it back into the town. And if we do the 315, it'll be all back into the town. And we'll all be able to see it for as long as we are here.
Okay. The key to the finance committee in being so strongly behind this is the fact that there will not be an impact on the tax rate, period. As getting back to the slide that Paul showed and Fred had shown earlier, there is no money coming out of general funds. There is the only potential monies that will have to be spent will be CPA monies, which will come if borrowing is necessary. That is money that will come out of future CPA money, not out of tax money. Without this project, as of our life, this will be finalized at town meeting, but projected on the meeting on Wednesday, a 14 cent per thousand, roughly 1% tax increase. If the town hall project is done, there'll be a 1% tax increase. Absolutely no difference, and the finance committee, as I said before, would not be behind this.
That's right.
If there was a tax increase, if it had any impact or could have any impact, even down the road on taxes, it will not.
Absolutely. So just to reiterate here, the time is now. You can read the slide, but as Fred said, the impact on taxes is not there, okay? And if you can remember, you can go back 3 years, and you can remember what town meeting was like and where the finance committee stood when it came to that $3.9 million town hall renovation. It was well-intentioned, it would have been a gorgeous thing. The town didn't have the stomach for it or the pocketbook. And that's how the finance committee felt about it. This project is a different project, and this project will not hit our pocketbooks, and we can have a great space to enjoy. So.
About to get into questions here, just one other thing I wanted to cover here and talk about the warrant for the annual town meeting and how you'll see these questions come about. So on the annual town, on the warrant for the annual town meeting, you're going to see four separate articles. There's going to be two CPA articles, and Alan referred to them. One is going to be the vote to appropriate the $340,000 of existing CPA funds, and the second one will be an article for a vote to borrow up to the $400,000 in to be backed with future CPA funds, so that's CPA borrowing. The third article is going to be the vote to appropriate the $315,000 that Paul and Fred talked about, and that's going to be from available funds. That's going to be the what's called the receipts reserved for appropriation account. Those are the monies from the sale of the cell tower easement. What's remaining of the $1.2 million. And then the fourth article is going to be a vote to authorize the select board to convey an historic preservation easement on the town hall contingent on the award of the third grant that Donna talked about, the Massachusetts Project Preservation Fund. A condition of that, of accepting that award, is that the town granted and historic preservation restriction on the property to Mass Historic Commission. So there's going to be four articles that you want to look for at the annual town meeting. It's the last item, right, Fred?
Yep.
Questions and answers. So I will kind of moderate this section, and I will defer to the experts where necessary. So anybody have any questions? Paul?
Yeah, I have a question. I'm curious if we're going to use the upstairs auditorium for concerts. Is there any plan for modifying the acoustic properties of that upstairs space? Because I'm not sure how good they are for musical presentations. And also, will there be an AV component so whoever wants to make presentations can use a projector of some sort with a screen on the stage, and maybe even have community movies occasionally like they do at the library, would be a nice thing. And lastly, along these lines, will there be Wi-Fi available? So if people want to use Wi-Fi in the building, they'll have that option. For instance, making presentations and using clips from the internet, it would be necessary to have Wi-Fi capacity. And I'm just curious as to how much consideration has gone to those matters.
George, you want to answer that?
Sure, I can at least start the answer on that. I'm George Dole from Jones Woods and Architects. The first question regarding to acoustic properties, we are aware of that. We're planning to have acoustic panels that will be flat against the wall above the windows on three sides, so the two sides with the windows in the rear of the stage area. So they'll be painted the same color as the rest of the room, but they'll provide a good degree of acoustic properties. If you want to see an example of it, we've done it in previous buildings with hardwood floors, such as the Wendell Public Library. The other two questions, in terms of the AV options, I might defer to Judy Marklin or someone else, because at some point we did some discussion in terms of what would be included in the budget for this project. And we believe that there may be some grant possibilities available for funding potentially on AV equipment in the future, but it's certainly planned for in the future. No, I put you on the spot, Judy.
You did. I think we're hopeful that a couple of private foundations might help fund AV equipment. Because they are interested in culture and that kind of thing. I don't think at the moment it's explicitly a part of the budget, but we have thought about it. I also think that the town has Wi-Fi. Isn't there a municipal Wi-Fi system that was in the building that can be reactivated?
There's currently internet access in the building now. But we'd have to set up. We need to buy some routers, wireless routers and things like that, and get those set up.
I would like to point out that Donna mentioned that the retrofitting is going to help lower the cost. Brian and I and George are involved with the energy modeling. And I was flabbergasted. We were lucky enough that we were able to model it as though the building were used full time for the grant, which depended on payback. And if it were used full time with the existing building, it was going to cost $15,500 a year to heat and electricity. With the new building, it was down to $5,500. And I think we're paying something on the order of $6,500 now. So I think things like Wi-Fi, to install it, hopefully won't be a huge additional expense.
No, I don't think so.
I don't know who the question is for, but I'm guessing maybe John. You mentioned about the chimneys. Can you say a little bit more about how the chimneys are going to be I assume closed off so that to keep the building envelope tight so that you can have those energy efficiency. Can you just say a little bit about that, please?
Yeah, initially I think the whole plan was to take them down below the roof line and seal them up. But then because of the historical aspect of that particular design, they are basically going to be taken down below the roof line and then rebuilt from there up. To make sure that they are solid and they're sitting on a solid base beneath the roof. And then I assume seal off because nothing's going to be in them.
Oh, so you don't know about exactly how does the how is it sealed?
The top will have a copper cap that will allow it to be keep water infiltration from coming in the brick, as John mentioned, will be repointed and reset as needed, and an epoxy consolidation put on it to protect the brick. In terms of actual air sealing from below, it would be just closed off at the source, so where the existing gas fire stoves come into the chimney, that will be sealed up and insulated at that location.
Okay.
Yes?
I have two questions. I'm George Reynolds, I live on Chestnut Lane. And the first one has to do with the sprinkler system or the lack of the sprinkler system. Someone mentioned the disaster in Rhode Island that caused the law to change, which is probably a good thing. Is it legal to have a large group of people in there, like 150 people, in the upstairs auditorium nowadays without the sprinkler system? Or would we have to wait until the sprinkler system was installed in order to have a larger group of people?
I'll defer to George again.
Again, as related to the station nightclub, there's specific rules in place for nightclubs, restaurant nightclubs, and the rationale behind that is that it's businesses that are serving alcohol, having loud music, and people gathering in nighttime conditions with low light. There's definite requirements for that type of a setup over a certain number of people. However, there's not a requirement in terms of the existing building, in terms of the building codes, for a gathering space, even up to 150 people. We've done complete code analysis and coordination with the building inspector. As John mentioned, there will be smoke detectors, heat sensors, a fire alarm system, and it's going to be a building that will have egress stairs well lit, a new exit stair off the back, as well as both of the front entry stairs, so they'll have more than enough means to egress out from the second floor. So there is not a code requirement for the building to be sprinkled.
Yeah, did I hear it right that if the two water systems are combined, that would solve the sprinkler problem? Is that correct?
The pressure problems that we don't have today. Yes, that is new.
I mean, the sprinklers could be put in at that point,
right.
Viably.
Right. But I think the other thing, George, quickly, there's also a square footage requirement, right, of 7,500 for when you actually do need sprinklers in a building.
In the buildings under the 7,500.
Oh, absolutely.
So,
Just one last note. In terms of the system, when the new water system is put in, the pipe is going to be set in from the street to the building that will allow for future sprinklers inside the building.
One last question around parking. So what has the negotiation been with the Whately Inn? I go by there some evenings and the parking lot is completely full of people eating at the Whately Inn. If there's a town event, who gets first dibs on the parking lot? So the Whately Inn would be told you can't park here tonight? Is that how it would work?
Yeah, we could put a sign up saying there's a town event, we can park out back along the street.
Or I guess depending on how we proceed to manage the building as a community center, whether we have police presence here or not, I guess that would be another way of trying to control that. But I guess at the same time, I guess when Whately Inn is not busy, I guess events at the town hall could spill over into the Whately Inn parking lot. So
you guys use our parking lot both ways.
It works kind of both ways.
Yeah, from the streets,
the parades, and stuff like that.
Any other questions? Guess not. Thank you all for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Paul Newman, closing comments?
No, I will generously give my time to the speaker, and thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you. Have a good night. There's a man up front if anybody wants to look at them.